the Center for Environmental Health, next on Enviro Close Up. Welcome to Enviro Close Up. I am Carl Grossman, and with me is Ansje Miller. She's the Eastern States Director of the Center for Environmental Health. The center describes itself as the leading nonprofit in the United States protecting children and their families from disease-causing chemicals in the water, in the air, in various consumer products. Ansje, welcome.
Thank you. Thank you very much for having me.
You have achieved so many victories, the center has. On flame retardant, can you tell the story about how you you exposed the dangers of flame retardant and changes were made?
So flame retardants are a really interesting story because they are very dangerous. They are carcinogens. Many of them are potent neurotoxins. And they are in products that we use every day. They're in the cushions and chairs like this. They're in the couches in our homes. And they come out in the dust. They're in children's nap mats, we found them. And the crazy thing about flame retardants in products is that they don't even actually work to retard fires. So here we have really dangerous chemicals, and they don't even serve the purpose that they're intended to use. So, you know, you kind of have to ask yourself, why are these dangerous chemicals in our everyday products if they don't even work? So you think about that story, and it goes back to the 70s. And if you'll remember in the 70s, as I do, there were a lot of house fires and that people were concerned about. And the reason that a lot of these house fires were taking place was because people were smoking. We had a lot more smoking at the time. And people would fall asleep as they're lying on the couch, going to sleep to Johnny Carson. A cigarette would be hanging, dangling, and smoldering, and it would catch a couch on fire, it would catch a bed on fire. And in order to combat this issue, people started looking at it and identified the fact that the cigarette was the ignition point. The solution then is pretty simple, is to make fire-safe cigarettes. But the tobacco company didn't want to do that. It just so happened that they were represented by a PR firm that also represented the chemical industry. So they came up with this brilliant idea, right? So instead of actually changing the cigarettes, which was working well for the tobacco company, why don't we create this whole new market for these chemicals and change the standard so that couches and beds would have to be doused with all these chemicals in order to meet the standard, and you change the couch, not the cigarettes. So that's what happened, and California passed this law called TB 117 that required that a couch would have to withstand an open flame for a certain number of, for a certain period of time in order for it to pass this standard. And the only way, basically, to meet that standard is to douse it with all these chemicals. And so that's how we ended up with the proliferation of all of these chemicals in everyday products, not just in California, but because the California market is so huge, a company isn't going to make one couch for the California market and a different couch for the New York market. So it ended up everywhere in the country. So that's how these toxic chemicals ended up in our products. We realized that these chemicals change our DNA. A lot of new science was coming out about that issue. And what we decided to do is to change the standard, to build awareness so that companies wouldn't have to put these chemicals in the products. Many of the furniture manufacturers, it was an additional cost. So they didn't want to be putting the chemicals in the products. So we changed the standard. In 2013, and now companies no longer have to put these dangerous chemicals in the couches.
How did you change the standard, and was that difficult?
It was not easy. As you can imagine, you know, it's been around for 40 years, so it's a hard thing to change. What we did was we worked with the scientists who had uncovered the fact that this was a problem and had done the testing about the health effects of these chemicals. We worked with firefighters who are really on the front lines of exposure to these chemicals. Firefighters walk into a home that's on fire, and not only are they exposed to just the flame, but what's really killing firefighters is the smoke that they're inhaling. And the reason is because this smoke has all of these chemicals in them that's causing cancers, really unusual cancers in these firefighters. Many firefighters are dying of cancers before they even reach retirement age, and that's because of all of the petrochemicals that we have in our homes that are being released and off-gassed into these fires that the firefighters are breathing. So we worked with the firefighters who said, hey, look, you know, the fire scientists are telling us that the chemicals don't work. They're making us sick. Let's change the standard. So we worked with firefighters, we worked with other advocates, we worked with scientists, and then doggedly working with the government agency, with the legislature, to change the standard.
Jumping to, well, a current big issue involving smoking, too, and the center has been in the lead here, e-cigarettes. Speak about what your challenge these days to the impacts of e-cigarettes.
It's kind of amazing how popular e-cigarettes have become when we've known the dangers of smoking for decades now. Clearly, smoking causes really significant cancers. One of the issues is nicotine, and e-cigarettes are not immune from that issue. In addition, e-cigarettes introduce formaldehyde, which is also a carcinogen. And we tested a bunch of the e-cigarettes and used a law in California called California's Prop 65, which says that if a product contains a chemical known to the state of California to cause cancer or reproductive harm, that at a minimum, it should be labeled so that consumers know, does this product contain a chemical that's going to cause cancer or reproductive harm? And then they can make a choice. So under that law, we tested a bunch of these products and found that most of the e-cigarettes do, in fact, contain cancer-causing chemicals. And it's really sad because people look to e-cigarettes and vaping as a safer alternative to smoking. And when the reality is, it's not safe either. And that people should clearly be warned about that fact. And what's even more nefarious is that many of these e-cigarettes are being marketed to children, just as the cigarettes were being marketed to children a long time ago that we no longer let them do. But these e-cigarettes are being produced with cherry flavors, with cartoon characters all over them, you know, It seems like just the bad old days of Joe Camel.
Does government protect us from these poisons, from these toxic chemicals?
People assume that when they go to the store shelves and buy something, that somebody's minding the store. That if a product is on the shelf, that means that it's safe for you. And the reality is just the opposite. Nobody is requiring a company to demonstrate that their chemical is safe, that the chemicals in the products that we're buying every day are safe. There's no requirement, and many times, therefore, companies don't even know what the chemicals are that are in their products, and they haven't been tested for safety. In fact, there are 84,000 chemicals on the market in the United States. And of those 84,000 chemicals, only 200 have actually been tested at all for safety and health. And that's not a thorough test, that's just, you know, one test. And so clearly we have a broken system. You know, nobody is, the system is not set up so that you actually have to demonstrate that your product is safe before you put it out on the market. And I think, you know, that's really what we deserve, especially when many of these chemicals can lead to learning disabilities like autism and ADHD, like reproductive harm, where men are seeing lower sperm count, where you're having a reduced anogenital distance in men, lower fertility rates, cancer, lots of diseases that these chemicals have been linked to, and yet companies don't have to demonstrate whether their chemicals, you know, cause any of these diseases or are safe.
We're speaking to Ansje Miller of the Center for Environmental Health. What's the deal? Are the regulatory agencies captured by these industries involved in peddling these poisons?
So part of the challenge is that the law that the United States has to regulate toxic chemicals is called the Toxic Substances Control Act. And back in the 70s, when we had this wave of environmental laws passed, many people have heard of the Clean Air Act, the Clean Water Act, Superfund, but the Toxic Substances Control Act, which is the law that regulates toxic chemicals, nobody has heard of. And the reason is because it was so ineffective that nobody can actually use it. One of the issues is that the EPA, under this law, doesn't have any authority to actually regulate the chemicals. So a company will submit information and say, okay, here's a new chemical that we're going to put on the market. And the EPA has 90 days to review the information that the company voluntarily decides to give. And if the EPA doesn't get to look through all of that material in that 90 days, the chemical just automatically goes on the market. And we all know how underfunded our EPA is. So there just aren't the resources. They don't have the regulatory teeth to be able to do it. And they don't have the authority to even ask for more data. So fundamentally, the law is broken. And then there is also an issue of the EPA being a captured industry, I mean, agency. So I think we've got both problems. The good news is that people are really starting to understand that this is a problem. I think there's widespread, not in the general public, but at least on the Hill, people are starting to understand that it's really time for the law to be changed. So there's an effort that's happening in Washington, D.C. right now to update the law. And so we're hopeful that we'll be able to get some reform out of this law, out of these changes. But I am not that hopeful that it's going to actually be enough to protect us all from all of the chemicals that are on the market.
How could people, I mean, it sounds to me that what's necessary here are people demanding that they and their children be protected from these toxic. What can people do? How can they connect with your center?
Yeah.
To organize is so important. And here's an organization, a leading, if not the lead organization in this area. What can people do and how can they link it up with the center?
Thank you for asking. That's a really great point. The chemical industry has spent $190 million trying to pass this law in a way that would actually make it easier for them to profit and not actually have to provide any safety or health. So what we really need is people speaking up, because people power, we know, is much more important than the number of dollars that they're throwing at this issue. So if you are passionate about this issue as I am, you can go to our website, Center for Environmental Health, and sign up. We have action alerts that update you about what's happening in Congress, what are the latest. We do product testing all the time to see what products have toxic chemicals in them that you should avoid, and where we've been able to work with companies to actually take the toxic chemicals out. So we'll keep you updated about that. So if you go to Center for Environmental Health or CEH.org, you can sign up for our action alert list and we'll keep you updated.
How did the center get started?
The Center for Environmental Health was started almost 20 years ago now. Our executive director, Michael Green, was also the founder. And he was a visionary. He started his career looking at solid waste issues in Dharamsala and got passionate about it at that point. He came to the United States, worked in the Department of Energy, particularly around environmental justice issues, and realized that working in the federal government isn't the best way to affect change. Things move very, very slowly. And connected with some folks in California who were familiar with California's Prop 65 and it's the power of that law to actually have individual people make change. So he moved out to California, worked with some lawyers, and started testing products. Some of the first things that we looked at, for example, diaper cream, and found out that diaper cream actually had lead in it. Lead is a really dangerous neurotoxin, and you know, if there's anything that shouldn't have lead in it, it's something that is designed to go on a baby's bottom right where there's open skin. And so, you know, it was pretty unconscionable that there'd be lead in a product like that. So Michael started this organization, worked with lawyers, tested those products, and sued the manufacturers to say, you know, hey, not only should you just be warning us because this is such a dangerous thing, but the lead isn't actually necessary. Go ahead and take the lead out. And so that was a huge successful victory that we've been building upon ever since. So from that, we were looking around and noticed that lots of children's products have lead in it. So we systematically went out and tested children's products for lead and then sued the manufacturers that we found in violation. And so to this day, you can go into a store and it's actually really hard to find lead in children's products. So that was a huge victory.
Another horror story, plastic turf. And this is something your center has been out in front on, plastic turf. Can you describe the dangers of plastic turf?
So there's a couple of things involved in plastic turf. One is one that we identified early on. The individual blades of grass in the plastic turf had lead in it. So the green pigment contained lead, and we, again, systematically tested that. We have a program where people can actually take samples of their turf, send it to us, and we'll test it complimentary. And so we did that systematically in a bunch of different fields, a bunch of different manufacturers that produce this turf, and found that it did indeed contain high levels of lead. And now when you think about turf, I mean, this is something that kids play on. They're falling, they're scraping themselves on it, easy access. It comes off in the dust, on their hands. Kids are, you know, lots of hand-to-mouth behavior. So really high levels of exposure. And so this is another example where we found this health problem, and then we reached a settlement with the manufacturers to get them to take the lead out of those blades of grass, out of this AstroTurf, the artificial turf. So that was another big success. Another issue that has been bubbling to the surface that we're still looking into is the crumb rubber that is in the turf. And some regulatory bodies, New York City is an example, where they are, you know, understanding that this is a problem. It's recycled crumb. It's recycled crumb tire, and they're saying that they can't, you can't use that anymore. There are safer alternatives out on the market. So first of all, you could just use natural lawns, and that's a great alternative. Another thing is that there are companies that are making this artificial turf out of coconut husks, which is a much safer alternative. So that's what we would recommend.
I've been involved in environmental journalism for many, many decades now. And you know, whether it's flame retardant, actually, or whether it's the catalog of poisons that you've been talking about, virtually all polluting processes and products I have found over the decades, absolutely unnecessary, but pushed by people and companies with special interests in them. We're talking to Ansje Miller today. She's with the Center for Environmental Health. How did you get into this field yourself?
So I am originally from a city called Camden, New Jersey.
Which is a big center of pollution, I must note.
Exactly. Yeah. And I remember as a kid, the hospital folks would come around and knock on all of our doors and test us for blood lead levels. And you know, I was young, so I didn't really understand it, but it got me thinking, you know, why is it that we might possibly have this dangerous chemical in our bodies? And, you know, learned a little bit about it and understood that it actually leads to reduced IQ, to learning disabilities. And, you know, over time, we didn't really understand it at the time, but, you know, looking back, there is also in Camden, there's a cement factory that is a classic environmental justice case. There is a hazardous waste site, which in Camden, there's not a lot of, there weren't a lot of playgrounds, places for kids to play. We mostly played on the streets. But I remember that the hazardous waste site was one place where kids had dirt that they could play in. It was a place that the boys would go. And I only learned later in my 20s that it was a hazardous waste site. There was no sign on the door, on the gate, and in the area. Nobody knew. And so that's one of the things that really sparked me to get involved in this issue, is just the idea that that there are these dangerous chemicals out there and nobody's watching over us. Nobody's protecting us from it. Nobody's letting us know even that these chemicals are around us and are leading to cancer and to learning disabilities. And, you know, especially in areas where there's high crime rate, not a lot of economic opportunity, there's stress because of all of those things. And one of the things that we're learning now is that, you know, there's this interesting interaction that goes on in our bodies. And so the extent to which any one person has negative health effects that come from exposures to toxic chemicals is actually quite linked to things like stress. So stress levels will actually affect whether we're going to develop learning disabilities because of our exposures to chemicals. So it's really an injustice issue. And, you know, knowing these things, I can't imagine not working on them to try to fix the problem.
Yeah, and really, we all live in Camden. I mean, there's no running away from these toxics, from these pollutants, and we have to demand that, government commits itself to our lives. I mean, the situation is absolutely outrageous. One last thing, and there's so many things to talk about. The center has been very involved in recent times in toxic discharges, not just from fracking. You've been involved in the fracking issues, but just in oil and gas production in general. Can you talk about that?
There's an it's a really interesting connection between the oil and gas industry and toxic chemicals. First of all, about 90% of the chemicals on the market are actually petroleum-based. So they're intricately linked in that way. And the way that we extract oil out of the ground, transport it to where it is that it gets burned so that we can use it for energy, the combustion process, to disposal, there are really dangerous health effects all along that life cycle. And one of the things that have been, you know, coming up over the past couple of decades or so is the increased use of unconventional extraction methods that utilize putting hundreds of chemicals down into the ground in order to get that last bit of oil and gas out of the ground, because we've already gotten the sort of low-hanging fruit in terms of our fossil fuels. And so we're really trying to get those hard-to-reach pockets of oil and gas. And in order to get that, we kind of have to use extreme methods at this point. And that involves pumping all of these chemicals into the ground. Many of those chemicals have been demonstrated to be endocrine-disrupting chemicals, for example. Endocrine—it's a big word, endocrine-disrupting chemicals. But basically, what that means is that these chemicals mimic the hormones that naturally occur in our bodies, and basically interfere with the natural processes that happen in our bodies. And so that could lead to, again, to cancer and to learning disabilities and to reproductive harm. And these oil and gas extraction facilities, many of them happen in rural communities, and the wastewater that's affiliated with that go into our groundwater. They're used in irrigation in our food so that we end up eating it. And in some cases, like in Los Angeles, the oil and gas extraction is actually happening in the city itself. And so this is a really significant issue. We really need to fundamentally rethink the way that we are powering our whole economy. There are renewable alternatives. You know, there's a whole slew of things that we could be doing if only we would prioritize health, because health is the most important thing that we have.
Amen. We've been talking to Ansje Miller. She's the Eastern States Director of the Center for Environmental Health, based in Oakland, California, but Ansje works out of the office in New York. An important organization to support, to get involved with. I'm Carl Grossman. You've been watching Enviro Close-Up. Thanks for viewing.